housing rally. President Trump unleashes on his critics.
You know how easy it is to be presidential?
But says be nice to Kim Jong-un.
We have to be very nice because let's see what happens.
Is President Trump giving in to the North Korean dictator's demands? Senator Ron Johnson, chairman of the Homeland Security Committee, is here next. Plus, 2020 already? The president goes off script.
Keep America great! Exclamation point.
Releasing his re-election campaign slogan and taking shots at some potential challengers.
I'd love to beat Oprah. I know her weakness. Can you imagine having to cover Elizabeth Warren, Pocahontas?
We have Senator Elizabeth Warren here in a few moments. And shocking proposal. President Trump praises repressive leaders.
These guys don't play games.
Zero tolerance policy. If we catch a drug dealer, death penalty.
And seems to propose the death penalty for drug dealers in the U.S.
I don't know that the United States, frankly, is ready for it. They should be ready for it.
Is this a policy his supporters will get behind? Anthony Scaramucci will be here just ahead.
Hello, I'm Jim Acosta in for Jake Tapper in Washington, where the State of Our Union is experiencing some major deja vu. President Trump is back in full campaign mode, going off on his rivals and going off script in a 75-minute rally in Pennsylvania. He was there to support Republican candidate on the ballot this Tuesday, Rick Saccone, but the president really seemed to be campaigning for himself, desperate to avoid another crushing loss in a special election. He even rolled out his new 2020 campaign slogan, Keep America Great! Exclamation point, and promising to remain true to himself.
Remember I used to tell how easy it is to be presidential? But you'd all be out of here right now. But you'd be so bored.
He also laid out his record on trade and the economy. The speech comes just days after the president's stunning decision to accept an invitation to meet North Korean leader Kim Jong-un, which Mr. Trump held up as an achievement that no other president has been able to accomplish.
They want to denuclearize. Nobody heard that. Hey, who knows? If it happens, if it doesn't happen, I may leave fast, or we may sit down and make the greatest deal for the world and for all of these countries, including, frankly, North Korea.
All right, joining us now to discuss this is Senator Ron Johnson, Republican of Wisconsin. He also is the chair of the Homeland Security Committee. Senator Johnson, thanks for joining us this morning.
Good morning, Jim. How are you doing?
Doing well. Now, you just heard what President Trump said in last night's rally in Pennsylvania. North Korea is, quote, thinking about denuclearizing, but, quote, who knows what's going to happen. Is that enough of an insurance for you, for the president, to sit down with Kim Jong-un? Is that enough?
Well, President Trump has been engaged in the maximum pressure campaign, and I joined in a letter with five other of my Republican Senate colleagues encouraging President Trump to make sure to maintain that maximum pressure until we see complete, verifiable, and irreversible denuclearization within North Korea. So what we can't do is what we did with Iran and let off the pressure and then just watch the behavior go in the wrong direction. So again, it's just incredibly important to keep, ratchet up the sanctions against North Korea until they actually do, in a verifiable fashion, denuclearize.
Okay. Now, North Korea has backed out of promises before. In 1994, they promised to end their nuclear program, but they were found later in violation of that. In 2005, they agreed to give up their nuclear program, but they started up again next year. They tested their first bomb, and then in 2012, they said they would stop testing, but later launched a satellite. Is the president just being naive here?
Let's hope not. Again, you have that history. Let's not be snookered again. Let's not be Charlie Brown to North Korea's Lucy. We've seen this movie before. That's why we've called on President Trump to make sure that we maintain the maximum pressure campaign. If anything, I would continue to ratchet up sanctions until they, again, have complete, verifiable, and irreversible denuclearization.
Isn't it possible they would back out of the talks before they even happen if you ratchet up sanctions? Seems like the president really wants to have this conversation.
Well, again, if you listen to members of his administration, they're pretty level-headed from a standpoint of we need to make sure that we continue to maintain that pressure. And from my standpoint, continue the pressure will bring North Korea to the table in a more good faith negotiations.
And the president also said, quote, we have to be very nice to Kim Jong-un. This is a dictator who has murdered untold numbers of people. What do you think the president is going to accomplish by being nice to Kim Jong-un?
Probably not a whole lot. What we need to do is maintain that pressure. We have to recognize the heinous acts committed by Kim Jong-un and, again, maintain the maximum pressure. It's that simple.
And I'm just correct me if I'm wrong here, Senator, I'm sensing from your voice that you're not so sure this is a good idea, sitting down with Kim Jong-un. You think it's a good idea?
Yeah, you know, I think talking to people is never a bad idea, as long as you maintain that pressure. I've never quite understood, you know, the enormous diplomatic gain by just sitting down and talk to somebody, as long as you maintain the pressure. So I'd rather talk to people to prevent any kind of miscalculation. And let's face it, miscalculation on the Korean Peninsula could be devastating. So I don't have a problem in talking to people, but we have to maintain.
Well, this isn't talking to people. This is talking to Kim Jong-un. This isn't. This is a very different ballgame.
Well, again, I think the maximum pressure campaign is having its effect. We need to isolate North Korea. They say they're self-sufficient. Well, we're putting them in a position where they're going to have to prove self-sufficiency, and of course they're not. And I think that maximum pressure campaign is bringing Kim Jong-un to the table for the first time, hopefully in good faith.
All right, well, and I want to talk about these new tariffs that the president announced on steel and aluminum. You've expressed your opposition to this. It obviously could affect the economy in Wisconsin. Your fellow Republican Senator Jeff Flake has gone so far as to threaten congressional action to nullify all of this. Would you sign on to that? Would you support that?
I would, but I doubt it'd have any chance of passing, or and even if passed, that we'd have the votes to override the veto. You know, what's unfortunate, Jim, is in Wisconsin, I just traveled the last 2 days talking to all kinds of folks. Confidence had really been building. We stopped increasing the regulatory burden, actually started reducing the regulatory burden. We made American businesses more competitive. We gave real tax cuts to Wisconsinites and Americans. There's a really growing level of optimism because we were returning certainty to the American and Wisconsin economy. And, you know, the talk of canceling NAFTA and now imposing these steel tariffs have just interjected uncertainty into the economy where it just wasn't necessary. So I'm really concerned that this is counterproductive. As well as you could really result in retaliatory actions by our trade partners. And again, it just injects uncertainty into an economy that was really doing quite well.
And I want to get back to this rally that we saw last night. The president was in rare form, or perhaps not so rare form. Take a listen to the president making the case for the death penalty for drug dealers. Let's listen to this.
When I was in China, and other places, by the way, I said, Mr. President, do you have a drug problem? No, 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 we do not. I said, huh, big country, 1.4 billion people, right? Not much of a drug problem. I said, what do you attribute that to? Well, the death penalty. So honestly, I don't know that the United States, frankly, is ready for it. They should be ready for it.
Now, the death penalty for drug dealers, is that something that you agree with? And should we be following China's lead when it comes to criminal justice?
I would say we probably should not be following China's lead when it comes to criminal justice. I'm a supporter of the death penalty, but only when in those types of instances where we absolutely are 100% certain that the person is 100% guilty. I'm not sure it would be applicable to drug offenses.
And the NRA is suing the state of Florida to block a new law that the governor just signed there, Rick Scott, that would raise the legal age to buy all guns to 21 years old. The NRA saying that it violates the constitutional rights of 18 to 21-year-old people. What do you make of that? Do you feel like that this law violates the Second Amendment? How far should the law go in that regard?
I would not support the law. You know, we send our sons and daughters over to Afghanistan, in Iraq. They defend our freedoms. I think if they do that, they ought to be able to have the right to buy a hunting rifle.
What about an AR-15? An AR-15 to 18-year-olds with AR-15s, that's okay?
I think what we ought to do is we ought to really detail what the operational characteristics are of weapons rather than just a scary name or a gun that looks a little bit scarier. You know, there are plenty of hunting weapons that basically have the same operational characteristics. Let's define the operational characteristics. And it's already illegal to have a fully automatic weapon. It's illegal to convert a legal weapon into an automatic weapon. So I would much rather concentrate on verifiable operational characteristics, and then we could evaluate the weapons based on that.
Okay, Senator Ron Johnson, thanks so much for joining us this morning. We appreciate it.
Have a great day.
All right, you too. Thank you, sir. President Trump last night announcing his reelection slogan, much to the surprise of his team, and taking aim at our next guest, Senator Elizabeth Warren.
Can you imagine covering Bernie or Pocahontas? Pocahontas, how about that?
Welcome back to State of the Union. I'm Jim Acosta. President Trump is already setting his sights on 2020. No surprise, calling out potential.
Or Pocahontas? Pocahontas. Can you imagine having to cover Elizabeth Warren for 4 years?
President also emphasized his new diplomatic approach to North Korea, touting support from regional allies. It's a strategy Democratic lawmakers like Senator Elizabeth Warren have been urging for months, calling on the president to try negotiating instead of threatening and taunting the North Korean leader. So are the president's fiercest critics now on board with the new strategy? And joining us now is Democratic Senator Elizabeth Warren of Massachusetts, also a member of the Armed Services Committee. Senator Warren, thanks for joining us on State of the Union. Want to start with North Korea. And South Korea is giving credit to President Trump's leadership and rhetoric for this meeting. I guess what the White House refers to as strategic rhetoric. But the Democrats have been saying that the president's talk of little rocket man and fire and fury was the wrong tactic and risk starting a war. Has the president's strategic rhetoric, as they call it in the White House, opened this door to a diplomatic breakthrough? Does he deserve some credit here, do you think?
Look, I am very glad to see this administration move toward a diplomatic approach to North Korea. And the principal reason for that is there is no military-only solution to the problems presented by North Korea. And it's, you know, I'm not the only one saying that. That is exactly what our generals in the field say. So it's good to move to diplomacy. The problem right now is that these are very complicated negotiations. There are a lot of issues involved in them. And our State Department has just been decimated. You know, we don't have an ambassador to South Korea. We don't have an assistant secretary for this entire region. There are all kinds of spaces that are open at the State Department generally, and particularly in this region. And that matters. When you're going into negotiations like this, it matters to have the people there first who are working and who are advising about the economy and about our military objectives and who know the players and know the history. So here's what I'm concerned about. I want the president to succeed. When the president succeeds in negotiations like this, the United States succeeds. It makes us safer. It makes the whole world safer. But I am very worried that he's going to go into these negotiations and be taken advantage of.
And another big issue we're going to be talking about this week is this bill that you are very interested in, the Senate. The Senate voted, as you know, to advance a new banking bill that would ease regulations on banks with assets that are less than $250 billion with the support of 16 Senate Democrats. You've been calling out members of your party who voted in favor of this bill, many of whom are facing difficult reelection bids in states that President Trump won. Do you think that voters should hold any Democrat who votes for this plan accountable at the polls? Would they be responsible if another financial crisis were to occur?
Well, look, let's talk about what the bill does. And what this bill says, here it is, on the 10th anniversary of the biggest crash since the Great Depression, this Senate is now advancing a bill that would celebrate that anniversary by saying that 25 of the 40 largest banks in America, these 25 banks together, sucked down more than $50 billion in taxpayer bailouts. Why? Because the economy needed them to stay up and running. Nobody went to jail. And this bill says, let's let those 25 banks be regulated just, you know, like they were tiny little community banks. I got to tell you, a quarter of a $1 trillion bank is not a community bank. So what's the consequence of doing that, plus other changes that help the remaining banks? The answer is, it puts us at much greater, puts us at greater risk that there will be another taxpayer bailout, that there will be another crash and another taxpayer bailout.
Yeah.
And you don't have to take my word for it. This
but
is
what about
the
your fellow? But what about your fellow
Office
Democrats going along with this? Are you disappointed that your colleagues are going to be voting in favor of this legislation? After all, you said that these sorts of loose rules on Wall Street helped cause the financial crisis in 2007-2008.
And that's true. It did help cause the crisis. Frankly, I just don't see how any senator can vote to weaken the regulations on Wall Street banks. And it's not just that. Can I point out a couple of things else that are in this bill that hasn't gotten much attention?
Well, I definitely want to move on to something that we want to talk about on the economic front, and that is the president really reaching out to blue-collar workers with these tariffs that were announced last week. Are you worried that Democrats are losing of these blue-collar workers that were so critical to the president's victory in 2016? And can your party bring them back? Joe Biden seems to be trying awfully hard to reach out to those kinds of voters. What do you think about that?
I don't think this is a political question. What I think is, I've been a longtime critic of America's trade policy. I think we've been negotiating trade deals for years that benefit giant multinational corporations and that don't help workers, don't help small businesses, and often don't even help consumers. What I'd like to see us do is rethink all of our trade policy. And I have to say, when President Trump says he's putting tariffs on the table, I think tariffs are one part of reworking our trade policy overall. We need a trade policy that's comprehensive, one that makes a distinction between the trading partners that follow the rules and the trading partners that break the rules, like China, but a comprehensive trade strategy that isn't all about multinational corporations' profits, but it's really about American workers and American small businesses. That's the kind of trade policy we need.
And I know we're pressed for time, but I have to ask you, because I cover the White House and I hear the president going after you from time to time, referring to you as Pocahontas. I know recently you were speaking about your Native American heritage. Does that get under your skin when he does that? And do you want to run for president in 2020?
I am not running for president in 2020, but let me tell you my story. You know, my mother and dad were born and raised in Oklahoma. My father fell in love with my mother when they were both still teenagers, and he was just head over heels over her. But his family was bitterly opposed to their relationship because she was part Native American.
And so does that bother you when the president calls you Pocahontas? Do you think that he is being disrespectful to Native Americans when he does that? Doesn't that bother you because of your family's heritage?
This is what I was trying to tell you. It's about my family's story, because my family's story is deeply a part of me and a part of my brothers. It's what we learned from our parents. It's what we learned from our grandparents. It's what we learned from our aunts and our uncles. I went to speak to Native American tribal leaders, and I made a promise to them that every time President Trump wants to try to throw out some kind of racial slur, he wants to try to attack me, I'm going to use it as a chance to lift up their stories. And I'm going to do that right now by pointing out that more than half of all Native women in this country have been the victims of sexual violence. And more than half of them are attacked by non-natives. And the American government is doing nothing about this. This is an issue that's happening right here in America. Native women are subjected to sexual violence at rates much higher than any other group in our country. We need to put some focus on this, and we need to make some.
Look who's back on the trail. President Trump back on the stump last night, as if he's ever left, back bragging about himself, going off script, taking aim at his critics. Is this a preview for 2018 and beyond? That's next.
Connor Lamb Lamb the sham, right? Lamb the sham. He's trying to act like a Republican, so he won't give me one vote. Look, I don't know him. Looks like a nice guy. I hear he's nice looking. I think I'm better looking than him. I do. And he's slightly younger than me. Slightly.
Entertaining as always, the President of the United States. We're here with our political panel to talk about this. Lamb the sham. Could he have done better than that, Anthony Scaramucci?
He could have probably. I think he's the best nicknamer ever. You know what I mean? I'm glad I'm on his team this way. I don't have to get the nickname.
Yeah. Not yet.
Not yet. Most people are in therapy after the nickname, though.
But what's interesting about this race is that the Democrats have actually put up a candidate who will campaign like a Republican who fits the district. It's interesting to me that he goes to such great lengths to distance himself from Nancy Pelosi, saying that he wouldn't support her as leader. And that's why this race is competitive. The more that Democrats realize that they need to move to the center and quit playing these identity politics and pandering to the progressive base, the more successful they'll be.
I think that's a little unfair in the sense that Connor Lamb is running as very pro-union. He has a series of proposals on health care. Even on guns, he has a different position than a lot of Republicans in that he's for background checks.
He's anti-Nancy Pelosi.
He is in a conservative district. And let's just remember, this is a district that Donald Trump won by 20 points. The Democrat is running neck and neck. Donald Trump had to campaign in this district, which should be a warning sign to Republicans that if this district goes, their House majority.
How bad is it, Anthony, if he loses this race, if the Republican loses?
Well, I think that's going to be the proverbial canary in the coal mine, right? And so if they lose this race, they've got to really hit a reset and figure out what they're going to do around the country. That's the heartland of Pennsylvania. My family's originally from the northeastern part of that state. And so I predict that they will win the race. The Republicans will win that race. It's closer than it should be. And if necessary, the president needs to put more resources there to help that candidate.
Bakari, how big of a deal is it? If this happens, how big of a deal is it?
Well, I'm not a big fan of moral victories, but I am watching this race to see how close it is. I mean, this wave is coming, whether or not Republicans want to be a part of it or recognize it or not. And you can't use Donald Trump's approval ratings to gauge how he will fare in 2020. I think that's unfair. There's no correlation there. But what you can use his approval ratings to show is how well they will do in the midterms. And I think that Democrats will come very close to taking back the majority because of the simple fact that Donald Trump has a poor leadership style, which is reflective in his approval ratings.
Yeah. I want to get to...
You're allowed to rebut that or no?
In a minute.
Well, let me play this and you can rebut it anyway. I want to play this because it was amazing. You know, here we are. We're a little ways off from 2020, and yet the president unveiled his reelection slogan. Let's listen.
Our new slogan, when we start running in, can you believe it, 2 years from now, is going to be Keep America Great! Keep America Great!
I'm glad he demonstrated what the exclamation point is because I forgot. Better than a question mark, I suppose. But MAGA versus CAG, Anthony, help us out here.
Okay, listen, I was in his office when he was formulating the Make America Great, and he's a great marketer, and we were talking about the Make America Great slogan. This slogan will catch on just like that one. Even back then, people were, oh, great controversy, America's already great, so on and so forth. But at the end of the day, even the MAGA thing has caught on at his base. As it relates to his leadership style, let's just look at the economic dashboard for a second. If I were a Democratic strategist, I would be sort of worried about where disposable income is right now. That tax plan downloaded about $30 billion of income spread out across the United States and in districts where the Democrats need to win. And so people usually vote with their pocketbooks.
I would be worried.
You guys consistently underestimate the president.
Listen, the economy is doing great, but still the president's approval ratings are so low, and that is worrisome.
I think that Republicans' hypocrisy sometimes is as thick as bologna sandwiches, as we say down south. But the fact is, we've had 84 straight months when Barack Obama was president of job growth and creation. The president, the 44th president, Barack Obama, inherited an economy that was in a recession, drug it out, created jobs in the auto industry, saved our auto industry. I mean, so to talk about where the economy is now, when Barack Obama was sworn in, the stock market was at 6,000.
I'm not talking about Barack Obama. I'm talking about the 2018 midterm election.
But I'm just saying you have to recognize
you guys consistently underestimate the guy.
What about those jobs numbers on Friday, Nira?
Let me just say one thing. That's true. I think Donald Trump made the point that wages are the big issue because there was big problems. There was big gains under both Barack Obama and Trump on jobs. But wages have been stuck. They were stuck on Friday. They've been stuck. I think that will be the big question about whether wages move up. But let me just say one thing about this on the tax cut. You don't have to listen to Democrats on the tax cut. Republicans ran ad after ad after ad in Connor Lamb's district, a district Trump won, on the tax cut. And it wasn't working. It wasn't moving the needle at all because those tax cuts are still not popular. People feel like they're not benefiting. And so it's so they had to move that and start. They just stopped running tax cut ads. This is an ineffective argument for Republicans.
It really
is. But you'll notice in that rally where Donald Trump
Okay, so I'll say the economy's not doing well. We're just talking about tax cuts.
Yeah. Let me have a second. Donald Trump is running. He's not going to run in 2 years. He was testing out themes at that rally, floating
out a new slogan.
You'll notice he didn't talk a ton about the tax cuts. He's floating out new themes. I thought it was very interesting how he had a big emphasis on the war on drugs. Even suggesting the death penalty for drug dealers.
Let's do this real quick, because one thing he is selling is himself, and he talked about this last night, that he's kind of throwing being presidential out the window. Here's what he said.
Remember I used to tell how easy it is to be presidential? But you'd all be out of here right now. But you'd be so bored. That's much easier than doing what I have to do. But this is much more effective. Don't forget, this got us elected. If I came like a stiff, you guys wouldn't be here tonight.
Anthony, I have to ask you this. There are children standing behind the President of the United States, and the President is saying, I don't have to be presidential. What kind of example does that set?
Well, I mean, that's because this is the mistake everybody's making about him. Okay, he's obviously very presidential, but he's also...
Wait, in what way?
What are you talking about? I mean, this guy, okay, hold on a second. Let's go to the North Korean situation. I think he's breaking new presidential ground in the North Korean situation.
I mean, that could be good or bad.
Because he's president, everything he does is presidential. That's not necessarily true. You guys don't like his style,
but he's making a very big point out there.
I'm trying to help out my Democratic friends here. You're underestimating the guy. If Barack Obama paid off a porn star $130,000, if he cheated on three wives, I mean, listen, the list goes on and on. If he had a handful of advisors that were either indicted or pled guilty, then there would be pitchforks in front of the White House. Mm-hmm. Presidential is not something that's associated with Donald Trump.
This is a good segue. He's going to win again in 2020. I mean, we may have to get a couch in here for some of you people. I mean, just listen to me.
What is this kind of talk, that if you raise an objection, you don't like him, you need a therapist, but you can't rebut anything I said about being presidential.
No, I actually can. Let's talk about it, okay?
Paying off a porn star is presidential.
Deregulation. He didn't pay off the porn
star. His lawyer did.
Wait a minute.
Anthony, you can't say definitively he did not pay off Stormy Daniels, right?
Well, Michael Cohen can say that definitively.
Why was that payment made?
Michael Cohen has been on the record definitively saying, we got to ask Michael Cohen why the payment was paid. But it was paid by Michael Cohen with Michael Cohen's money. And so at the end of the day, I would be very careful. I was Stormy
Daniels. Just because the check doesn't have the president's big signature on it.
There's a side agreement that's basically with Donald Trump.
I can tell you what we can definitively say. That's not presidential, though.
You guys were all over the map.
Let's bring it back in. The guy is presidential because... he is the president.
No, that's not how it works. The economy is booming.
It is how it works, actually.
Well, he's the president. We're going to have more to talk about this in the next...
That's the definition of a tautology right now.
All right, everyone, stick around. Hold on. President Trump also brought up First Lady Melania Trump last night. Anthony will want you to weigh in on that, saying her life has been not so easy. What could he possibly be referring to? That's next.
Here's tonight at 9 on CNN.
When I was in China... and other places, by the way. I said, Mr. President, do you have a drug problem? No, we do not. I said, big country, 1.4 billion people, right? Not much of a drug problem. I said, what do you attribute that to? Well, the death penalty. So honestly, I don't know that the United States, frankly, is ready for it. They should be ready for it.
President Trump heaping praise on the Chinese justice system, Amanda Carpenter, floating the prospect of executing drug dealers in this country. What's going on here?
I thought this part of his discussion was fascinating. Was it extreme? Yes. But is he absolutely on to something and pushing the envelope on this issue? Absolutely. I mean, people are dying in their cars, in the streets as a result of this opioid crisis. But here's my question. The drug dealer in this case is Big Pharma. I want a discussion of how we stop these drugs from just flowing through the country and being abused in such ways. This isn't a case where we're going to, you know, track down a gang leader and throw him in jail and incarcerate him, give him the death penalty. It's much more complicated. And if he wants to take on Big Pharma for this, I'm all for it.
And Anthony, you're opposed to the death penalty.
Yeah, listen, I'm totally opposed to the death penalty. I would tell my Republican friends it's the most uneven application of the law in the United States. You know, 30 years ago, I did a paper on it. If you're smart and you can lawyer up, you don't get the death penalty. If you have a low IQ and then you're in a rural place, and frankly, if you're African-American and you know this, Bakari, you end up getting the death penalty. Okay, and so to me, I think it's completely unfair. As it relates specifically to the drug situation, though, the president is onto something, and we have to figure out how to cut the source, and we have to be aggressive about it. But I'm not a big fan of the death penalty because it doesn't apply itself evenly across the society.
So one of the things that we have to be careful about, and I think that Donald Trump, I wouldn't necessarily expect him to necessarily be a student of history, but we've gone down this path before. And I think that what we saw with Ronald Reagan's war on drugs, what we saw with the 94 crime bill and Bill Clinton, it was bad precedent, bad law, bad policy. Because what we did was we broke families apart. And during that time period, we didn't treat the crack epidemic the same way that we're treating the opioid epidemic. And what we have is entire generations of individuals who've been taken out of their homes, who have been put away for years upon years upon years simply because they're dealing marijuana. We have to have a holistic approach to this. And I think that the path that the president's going down, I wish that someone, if I could talk to President Trump about one thing, it would be about this: how to unravel this issue, how to talk about this issue in a way that not only endears himself to minority communities that are affected and those individuals like you're talking about, but also creates policy moving forward.
And Nira, I want to jump ahead because one of the other things he talked about last night was the wall. It's one of his most popular lines, obviously, in his campaign speech. We have a little bit of that. Let's play what he had to say last night about that.
I will say we will build the wall. We have to build the wall. We have to build the wall. And the Democrats are holding it back. You know, we had a deal, $25 billion. And by the way, if I get $25 billion for the wall, you're going to have a lot of change. You're going to have a lot of change. I've got all the big builders, the best ones in the world. I know the best builders. You know, we want to use the good builders, not the bad ones.
Nira, he's got all the best builders.
I'm glad he's got the good ones and not the bad ones. I'd say, there's no wall. Who knows if there will ever be a wall? I doubt there will be a wall.
He's going to California on Tuesday to look at prototypes.
The odd thing about this whole situation is he had a deal in front of him, a deal not many Democrats really liked, but a deal to do essentially some investment in the wall for DACA dreamers. The president refused that deal. Actually, let me be clear about that. He accepted the deal. John Kelly called 4 hours later, who seemed to speak for the president, and said he doesn't want the deal. So the president himself has basically, at this point, made the dreamers be out there on their own and isn't getting his wall. So I would say that's not the greatest negotiating skills. Yeah. Maybe make people a little worried about his negotiating skills in North Korea.
And I want to make time to get to this because we were talking about this in the last segment, Anthony. Let's talk about the president and what he's had to say last night about the first lady. This was interesting.
Take Melania. Great, great first lady. She's great. She's great. She is great. You think her life is so easy, folks? Not so easy.
No.
Anthony, the president on his way up to this event was asked by CNN yesterday about whether he had had a relationship with Stormy Daniels. He did not answer the question. Do you know whether or not he had had a relationship with Stormy Daniels?
I don't know that situation, but let's talk about Melania for a second, okay? She's a wonderful person. She's a great mom. She's a great friend. I got to know her on the campaign, and even though I was only in the White House for 11 days, had the opportunity to have dinner with her, and we traveled on Air Force One together. She has a ton of grace, a ton of dignity, And I think when you're talking about the opioid situation, she's a deployable asset for the White House that they should get out there to speak in those communities. And so when he says that her life is not easy, I know what it's related to. They're taking incoming from everywhere. And the negative press and the bias related to her, and you see, the body language.
No, but I mean, Melania was an original birther.
Okay.
So here we go.
I want to give Nero the last comment.
Okay, whatever you want to say about Melania, it's not the outside world that's affecting Melania. It's the president's own actions. The 16 women who accused him of credibly accused him of assault, and the Stormy Daniels situation.
Look, I'm going to speak on her behalf. She knows a lot of that stuff is actually not true.
Let me.
How do you know she knows it's not true?
I've talked to her about it.
You can't say it's not true, so you don't know what
Let me tell you something. If a woman says that she met Melania in front of Trump Tower when she never takes anybody in front of Trump Tower,
the bottom line of the situation is that you have a case where the president's lawyer paid a woman's silence to suppress information from the voters. That is why it matters. It's not about Trump's marriage.
I got to stay in New York because the double standard and hypocrisy in Washington is like literally off the chart, okay?
Anthony traveled.
It was okay to protect the Clinton family.
That wasn't okay.
It was okay to protect the Obama family.
Okay.
Let's protect the people in Trump
Anthony,
that deserve to be
there. Let's give Anthony the last word there.
We're going to give
Anthony traveled the farthest. He gets the last word. All right. Thanks very much, guys. President Trump, I think he did. President Trump knows who he wants to face in 2020.
Wouldn't we love to run against Oprah? I would love it. I would love it.
Oprah Winfrey opens up about her political future and Donald Trump in a brand new CNN interview. That is next.
Oh, I'd love Oprah to win. I'd love to beat Oprah. I know her weakness. No, I know her weakness.
That was President Trump taking aim at Oprah Winfrey last night. Oprah insisted she is not running. Take a listen to what she told our very own Van Jones.
We live on a planet where there is darkness and light. You know, one of the things, I am not running for office. So I'm not letting you go there. But if I were running for office, and I will say to whoever is going to run for office, do not give your energy to the other side. Do not spend all your time talking about your opponents. Do not give your energy to that which you really don't believe in. Do not spend an ounce of your time on that.
Well, help us, though. Help us, though.
Listen, so don't spend your time on that.
Preach. You said I would preach. You preach. I love it. Let me tell you what you mean. But let me just push back for a second because, you know, I got my love army. I go out there. I try and tell people, let's not become what we're fighting. Let's not be what we're fighting. You know what they tell me? They tell me, shut up, Van, because we got bigots out here. We got Nazis out here. We're getting bullied. We're tired of going high. We want to go low and kick them into private parts. So...
there will be some people who do that, but you will not eventually win.
And here with us now is Van Jones. Van, what did you think? That looked like a great interview.
Listen, when we first reached out to her, we were thinking if we could get 5 minutes, 10 minutes with Oprah. She came, she stayed the whole hour. She took over the show. She brought Ava DuVernay with her. It is an hour of that kind of stuff in terms of, she's at a different level. I mean, she is just at a completely different level of understanding of the country. Look, she says she's not running. I believe she's not running. But, man, Trump better watch himself. He keeps asking for it. I think she'd run over him like a Mack truck. I mean,
she's not going to stay silent, it sounds like.
Hey, listen, when she starts talking, the entire audience just gets it. I mean, she hypnotizes you, man. Her understanding of what mistakes Democrats are making. I hope Democrats watch this interview because she just points out we spend so much time defining Trump as what we're against. We never define what we're for, and that's not going to work. I mean, I'm not saying it's because it's my show. I mean, she took it over. It's the Oprah show, but she is unbelievable in this interview for an hour, not 3 minutes, not 8 minutes, an hour. So you haven't seen this kind of stuff from Oprah Winfrey since she left the Daily Show.
Fantastic. Well, we're all going to be watching Van. It's a great interview. You can see the full interview with Van Jones with Oprah Winfrey on our special episode of The Van Jones Show. That is tonight at 8 p.m. Eastern right here on CNN.